Thanks very much indeed, Maura. I'm very, very glad to be here. It's my first time in Derry for 21 years, I realised, counting back. I came here for an early INCOR ARC conference on the internet and conflict resolution back in early 1996. Do I need to speak louder? Or am I too loud? Yeah. I'm also monitoring mic very carefully at the back of the room to make sure that I'm still in sound and vision, because this is being recorded for posterity. I'm really pleased about my association with the with INCOR and with Ulster University, so much so that I've actually got two business cards done. There's my ordinary business card that just says Nicolas Whyte, and my special one that says Professor Dr. Nicolas Whyte, which I give mainly to Germans, because it works better for them. In my work capacity as Senior Director for Global Solutions and Fire Alarms at APCO Worldwide in Brussels. So we'll just pause for a moment. Oh, that was painless. Right. So in my professional life, I'm a sinister lobbyist attempting to bend European policy to the will of my corporate masters, which fills up the day quite nicely and pays fairly well. I'm also working on the global eradication of polio, and I will take questions on that after. But I'm here because since 1998, I've been running a website which is devoted to tracking the results of the Northern Irish elections. Back in 1998, the web was still young. It was still a bit of a niche interest, and I cornered the market quite early and set up on my own time, in my own space, a website that archived all of the results from the 70s up until that time, which was then 25 years and now, of course, is getting on for 45. I did that kind of off my own bat for about 5 years, and then it occurred to me that this was really becoming too valuable a resource to be in the hands of one uncontrolled director. So I negotiated with ARC, and very much particularly with Mike, who was instrumental in the early stages of doing this, and we transitioned it onto the ARC website as one of the component parts, ARC being the conflict archive, which is jointly managed by Queen's University and by Ulster University. Two years ago, we decided to formalise the arrangement with Ulster University, and they appointed me to the visiting professorship, which is why I'm here. Now, my presentation is going to mix around the order of these things a little bit. I will probably more start with parties and then move on to votes and people, because that's just the way the spirit moved me at the time. I thought, before getting into the positions of the parties, we should ask the existential philosophical question: what is a political party actually for? We sort of take them for granted in political discourse. And I worked on democratization in Bosnia, and I worked on post-transition democratic politics in a number of countries, including South Sudan, which is a very special case. And it seems to me that a political party fulfills four main roles. The first is that it's a mechanism for patronage. This is how political parties actually developed in the UK in the 18th, 19th centuries. It is a pool of sympathisers from which political leaders can make political appointments, and also other governmental appointments. But it's basically how you make your party of people on whom you can rely. Since the mid-19th century, political parties have also become a mechanism for winning elections. Because our leaders are chosen by elections, you need a vehicle through which you institutionalise the campaigning function, so that you don't have to reinvent your election machinery from scratch every time there is a vote. Although I have to say, being on the other side of it, it sometimes seems like that anyway. It's also, on the more ideological side, a political party can be a mechanism for achieving political change. It's a base for activists who want to change the world. They can get together, they can influence the government to make it happen. But I think in Northern Ireland particularly, parties tend to end up as being a mechanism simply for representation of sectoral interests within a society. This is true in other countries as well. I live in Belgium, which is very deeply divided between the Flemish and Walloon, or Flemish and Francophone sides. But what this does is it institutionalizes a political voice for a particular group of voters, And then the question is, does the wider political system also allow for those voters to be represented in the decision-making process in government? But that's for a different seminar. This one, I'm talking about what political parties are and what they do. What do the Northern Ireland parties stand for? Actually, quite a good question. On the bus this morning, I thought I didn't really know the answer, so I went through the websites, and just for your amusement, this is the mission statement, the tagline on each of the party websites for tomorrow's election. The DUP, let's keep Northern Ireland moving forward. That at least has a sense of dynamic, if not actually very much substance. But nonetheless, it's clear which way they want to go, forward and not backward. I'd love to see a party run election on let's go backwards. Ulster Union is doing what's right for Northern Ireland, because of course no party ever won an election saying they're going to do what was wrong. Alliance Party, change dot for good. I hate the punctuation of this. There's no space between the full stop and for, and there's no full stop after good. So, I appreciate the sentiment. I just don't like the way it's presented. SDLP, this is not punchy. I did hunt through the SDLP's webpage for a punchy statement that I could use. That has got 32 words, I think, as compared to the DUP's 6, Ulster Unionist 6, Alliance 3. I think it's a bit too long, I think it's a bit aspirational, and I think it doesn't really say what you'll get on the 3rd of March if you vote for the SDLP on the 2nd of March. This is a criticism that can be levelled at other parties as well. Sinn Féin, stand up with us for equality, respect, integrity. I actually like this one the best. I think it conveys several values, and it's also an invitation to the voter to actually, you know, do something in return for which they will get something. The DUP does that a little bit with, you know, let's keep Northern Ireland moving forward, which is an invitation. Green Party, for the common good, not much different from Alliance, better presented, less original. The People Before Politics, a voice for people, community and environment. That speaks very much to the last, that's explicitly towards the sectoral representation function that I mentioned earlier. I thought that was interesting that they'd come up with that. And TUV, their website was down when I checked it this morning. So they may well have a punchy slogan, but I wasn't able to access it. I'm sorry for not doing my research more timely. They're draining the swamp. Well, that's not original and also not accurate. My favourite one, just in terms of humour, is UKIP in East Antrim, who are the one small party that might also win a seat. And their tagline is, "We promise not to burn your money." That actually is quite funny, although it wouldn't make me vote for them. Northern Ireland's political parties are relatively young compared to the UK and Ireland. I'll make that comparison. So, going in order, Sinn Féin founded in 1905, but really the current Sinn Féin is the people who split off in 1970, not the people who remained. Ulster Unionists also founded in 1905, but I mean really from 1974 it was not the same party it had been in 72. DUP founded 71, Alliance 70, SDLP 70, Green Party 83, People Before Profit 2005, TV 07. Having said that, by international standards, this is actually quite stable. As I said, I live in Belgium, where two of the four parties in the current government, both the party of the Prime Minister and the largest of the Flemish parties, have basically reinvented themselves in the last 5 years. In France, you're seeing a situation where Fillon's party, the Union for Majority, was basically invented 10 years ago. Similarly, you know, in the Netherlands, we're seeing a new political party emerging. Actually, it's surprising that we have not seen more change among the leading five political parties in Northern Ireland. It's basically been the same five leading parties since the collapse of Vanguard in the late 1970s, which is 40 years. So it could be that we're due for a change. How are the parties doing in terms of gaining wider support? In last year's Assembly election, I should say, the next few minutes, 10 minutes or so, are going to be all about last year's election, because it was really fascinating, and because I can't talk about this year's election yet, but you can watch me on BBC on the Friday night and Saturday morning, and I'll talk about this year's election then. But last year, what was interesting, all five parties lost vote share. The Ulster Unionists had the smallest drop, down 0.6%, still their worst result ever at 12.6. Alliance Party down 0.7%, DUP down 0.8%, and now the big losses, SDLP down 2.2% to also their worst result ever at 12% of the vote, and Sinn Féin down 2.6% to 24%, which is not a historic low. Where did those votes go? They went all over the place, really, but in particular they went to smaller parties. The Green Party pretty much trebled its vote share from 0.9% to 2.7%. People Before Profits quadrupled its vote share up to 2%. Still not very much, but nonetheless it's a lot better than nothing and got them two members of the Assembly rather than zero. TUV went up a bit, didn't do them much good electorally. UKIP also went up a bit. And independents and smaller parties gained quite a lot. So we're seeing a fragmentation is too strong a word, but an erosion of the lead of the big parties. The striking thing to me was the fall in the vote share for nationalist parties. And given that there is a mythology about the rise in the Catholic share of the population overall, this is worthy of further investigation. The biggest fall was in West Belfast, where the combined vote for SDLP and Sinn Féin, that's what I mean by nationalist parties vote, went down by a massive 17.5%. That's more than one-sixth of the total vote going. Here in Foyle, likewise, more than 10% drop. North Belfast, almost 9%. West Tyrone, 5.5%. Durand Armagh, 5%. East Derry, likewise, nearly 5%. Upper Bam, 4%. North Antrim, 4%. And the one constituency where the nationalist vote actually rose last year was Lagan Valley, from not very much to 0.7% more than not very much. They're hoping to do better tomorrow, and they may well do better tomorrow. Investigating the reasons for this, there are special circumstances in every case. People Before Profit Alliance, their new vote more than explains the drop in nationalist vote in West Belfast. Clearly they were getting votes not only from Sinn Féin and SDLP, but from people who'd voted else for other parties before or had not voted at all. Likewise here, Eamon McCann got most of that 10.8% drop, not all of it, but most of it. And there were a number of local independents, as I'm sure you will remember. North Belfast, not so obvious. The drop in the nationalist vote is nearly 9%. People Before Profit got about a third of that. The turnout was up a bit in North Belfast. This may be significant. Let's follow this through. West Tyrone, no other candidates. Well, a few sort of SDLP defectors, but it doesn't explain the whole thing. Turnout down 4%. Durand Armagh, turnout down a whisker. East Derry, turnout down a bit more. Upper Bam, turnout about the same. North Antrim, turnout down 2%. Lagan Valley, turnout down 3%. This is comparison with 2011. What becomes clear is that the turnout pattern varies. It's generally down in the areas where nationalist parties lost votes, in an election where it wasn't down by that much overall. So it suggests a reluctance from nationalist voters, or from those who'd voted for nationalist parties in 2011, to repeat it in 2016. Let's look at the other side. How did the unionist vote share change in which constituencies? East Derry, it went up. Upper Bam, it went up. Those are two actually quite similar constituencies in terms of vote share and population distribution. Not in many other ways, I have to say, but South Antrim, again, unionist vote up 4.5%. North Antrim, 3.5%. Where it decreased, Strangford down by nearly 4%. East Belfast down by nearly 10%. Why? Well, in East Londonderry and in Upper Bam, you would almost look at it and say, gosh, a number of people who voted nationalist parties in 2011 decided that they were unionists in 2016. This seems unlikely, but it's an interpretation that would fit the numbers. South Antrim, again, unionist rise correlated with nationalist drop. North Antrim, again, fairly close. So something's happening here. Doesn't go across the board. In Strangford, the unionist vote falls. The nationalist vote also falls from very little to 1.2% less than very little. In East Belfast, there's a strong rise in support for the Greens and for Alliance, and the Sinn Féin SDLP vote is pretty much off the scale. So I thought, let's look at this from the other direction. Let's see how turnout is changing across Northern Ireland. I'm going to step back a year to the Westminster elections, in fact, I'm going to step back 20 years to previous Westminster elections. This part of the world used to have a reputation for very, very high electoral turnout. In the Westminster election 2001, across the whole UK, the top four turnouts were in Mid-Ulster, West Tyrone, Fermanagh South Tyrone and Newry and Armagh, and the other 647 constituencies in England, Scotland and Wales, and the other Northern Ireland ones were less. So in 2001, Northern Ireland topped the scale. 2005, a little bit of a change. The top six turnouts were West Dorset, Fermanagh South Tyrone, so that's one out of two. Mid-Ulster, North Norfolk, two out of four. Richmond Park, West Tyrone, three out of six. Three out of the six top turnouts in Northern Ireland in 2005 were, in the UK, were in Northern Ireland. In 2010, things change. In 2010, Fermanagh and South Tyrone, with a 68.9% turnout, which you will see is a lot less than had been scored a few years previously, ranked 179th of the 650 seats elected to the UK Parliament. And no other Northern Irish seat was even in the top 400. In 2015, Fermanagh and South Tyrone still scores a little bit. It was all the way up to 68th from 179th. Still, no other Northern Ireland seat was in the top 400. The next, I think, was West Tyrone at 422nd. And in fact, in the bottom 20 turnouts, five Northern Ireland seats were in those last 20. So we have shifted from being a high turnout to a modest to low turnout voting population. Let's look at how turnout changed specifically in specific seats in the Assembly. And here I've ranked where the votes changed in a positive way here on the left. East Antrim up, North Down up, East Belfast up, North Belfast up. Those are all unionist majority constituencies, at least for now. South Belfast, more difficult to classify that way. Strangford, South Antrim, Lagan Valley. Basically the vote has increased last year in unionist leaning constituencies, but the vote did not increase for the unionist parties, as we have seen from an earlier table. Where did the vote go down? Went down a little bit in West Belfast, a lot more in Mid-Ulster, West Tyrone, Fermanagh South Tyrone, South Down, East Londonderry, Newry and Armagh, North Antrim, Foyle, Upper Bown. Of those 10 seats where the vote decreased, seven of them, I think, are nationalist majority and three unionist majority. So that becomes a much clearer picture. Last year, fewer nationalists were voting for nationalist parties in nationalist areas, and they were not switching, they were simply not coming out at all. Why? I don't know. Is this a permanent state of affairs? No, it's not, because only a few weeks later, this was completely confounded by the turnout in the Brexit referendum. I'll come back to the Brexit referendum at the very end, but the turnout figures were pretty astonishing, and it wasn't commented on very much at the time. Here I've ranked the top nine seats by referendum turnout. Fermanagh and South Tyrone retains its rightful place at the head of the table. The differential was not that much, 3% higher. I've coded them, by the way. It's meant to be blue for those who voted Remain, but it doesn't look very blue to me, and red for those who voted to leave the EU, Lagan Valley, North Antrim, East Antrim, Strangford. What's striking to me about this is that we're seeing that the referendum pulled out voters in unionist-leaning seats who do not usually vote at all. That there you see, you've got North Down, a massive 17% increase in people turning out to vote in the referendum who could not be bothered to put their one beside a candidate in the Assembly election a few weeks earlier, and likewise did not bother in Westminster the year before. Similarly, Lagan Valley, South Belfast, East Antrim, Strangford, North Antrim, unionist heartland, as it were. And unionist heartland where people are not voting for unionist parties, but they are voting on the future of Britain in the EU. Areas with less turnout. West Belfast had not only the lowest turnout in Northern Ireland, but the lowest turnout in the United Kingdom. Narrowly below central Glasgow, which I think was on 51%, 52%. Quinton is nodding at me. So if Quinton nods, it must be right. Similarly, areas with low turnouts, Foyle, North Belfast, East Londonderry, Mid-Ulster, West Tyrone, South Down, nationalist heartland, basically was not all that enthusiastic about the Brexit referendum. They tended to vote to stay, but they didn't tend to vote to stay in very big numbers. So there was an accusation floating around on the day after of sort of shy nationalists not coming out to vote. I think that misunderstands the situation. I think it may be true for West Belfast. I think what we're seeing in other cases is shy voters who cannot usually be bothered to vote for the political parties on offer at Northern Ireland's usual elections, but were motivated to vote in the referendum. So, in summary, what happened in last year's Assembly election? The vote for all the traditional large parties slipped. There's increased support for independents on all sides and for small parties. My father, who some of you will have known, always had a particular affection for micro-parties and the like. He said, you learn a lot about the carpet by looking at the colour of the fringe, in terms of fringe parties and so on. Turnout up in unionist areas, but not necessarily for the main unionist parties, perhaps for the smaller ones. Turnout generally down in nationalist areas, and also particularly for the nationalist parties, whose vote was hit quite massively. And the June referendum pulled out new voters, especially in unionist areas. So is this a new normal level of engagement? Question to hold on to till the end. Shifting to what comes next. This my nice little map of who won which seat in the Westminster election 2 years ago. This year we have a different number of seats in the Assembly that's going to be elected. The original Stormont had 52 members of the House of Commons and 26 senators who didn't do very much. For those of you, some of you probably know this, but the system was that 24 senators were elected by the 52 MPs by PR, which is a fairly crazy system of 52 people electing 24. I think they did it kind of in halves, 12 at a time. And the other two were the Lord Mayor of Belfast and the Mayor of this fair city. The Senate had been bolted on as an afterthought to the Government of Ireland Act, because the original plan was going to be really good, because they were going to have separate parliaments for Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland, for the six counties and 26 counties, but they would have a shared Senate, and that was going to work really well. And then someone said, actually, it's not going to work. So they came up with a back-of-the-envelope plan for the Northern Ireland Senate. The 1973 Assembly, the Convention in 75, the 1982 Assembly all had 78 members, which is 52 plus 26 from the old Stormont. In the mid-80s, the Westminster seats were all redrawn. We got 17 instead of 12, and they're all much the same size. So at that point, the Boundary Commission, rather than recommending that they kind of give four to this one and five to this one, just said, well, let's just give them all five, and that was accepted. Although, of course, no Assembly was ever elected on that basis. When the Boundary Commission recommended an 18th seat in 1996, they maintained their recommendation of five Assembly members per constituency. And so if there'd been an Assembly in 96, it would have had 90 members. In fact, what we got in 96 was the forum election, in which I myself was a very unsuccessful candidate. And that took the 90 seats, five per constituency, for the hypothetical Assembly, and added a bonus 20, which was two for each of the 10 biggest political parties by vote across Northern Ireland, which was a crazy system, which I hope is never adopted again. But that meant that the total number of members of the Northern Ireland Forum and the total number of delegates at the Mitchell talks was 110. Literally the last thing decided on the morning of Good Friday, for the Good Friday Agreement, was to shift not to the 18 times 5 Assembly, which had been kind of taken for granted, but to the 18 times 6 Assemblies, the system that has obtained up until tomorrow, where the 18 constituencies each elect 6 MLAs. And that was then changed 2 years ago by the Stormont House Agreement, where pretty much every party was prepared to swallow. And when I say pretty much every party, I mean Sinn Féin, the DUP, was prepared to accept a cut from 6 members to 5, because analysis, including my analysis, suggested that they would be hit not too badly compared to the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP. The lesson of Thursday may well be that you should be careful what you wish for. It may well not work out as smoothly as people have thought. How is it going to work out? Well, the most obvious effect that moving to 5 seats has is that the quota, the number of votes that you need formally to get elected, goes up to 1/6 of the vote rather than 1/7, 16.7%, not 14.3%. So a party that squeezed in with half a quota last year is going to find it much more difficult with 0.4 of a quota this year. And a party defending three seats with less than 2.5 quotas is very likely to lose one of those. And that can give rise to immense squabbles for internal party resources, because which of the three is going to volunteer to take the job? Actually, in North Down, Peter Weir, in an extraordinary display of statesmanship, has decided that he will not stand for re-election in North Down and will allow the two sitting DUP members to take the two seats between them. He is, however, standing next door in Strangford, where there are 8 unionists defending at the maximum, I think, 4 seats. So that will be 6 outgoing MLAs defending 4 unionist seats. So that will be entertaining to see how that works out. Yeah. I think this is going to have an unexpectedly negative impact in all kinds of ways. As I've described, it makes parties tighten their internal scramble for resources and legitimacy within the party structures. That is going to mean, first of all, that the parties themselves are going to take a harder line in the post-election negotiations, because they will have been forced to take a hard line internally in the course of the election campaign. And secondly, you know, I think I actually regret the reduction on reflection of 290 from 108. It means that the talent pool available from elected members of the Assembly is going to be drastically reduced. Personally, I think that ministers need not necessarily be elected members, and I know this goes against the Westminster parliamentary tradition, which has been slavishly copied by both parts of Ireland. But actually, in most European countries, a government minister does not need to be a member of the elected parliament. And that means that you have a much broader pool of people to draw from. They must, of course, be accountable to it. And you never lose sight of the politics. But it's just something worth bearing in mind. That is not a reform that is going to be affected tomorrow, or indeed in the next 5, 10 or 20 years. What effect is there going to be from the Nesbitt pledge, by which I mean the leader of the Ulster Unionists, Mike Nesbitt, as you're all well aware, commented that he would transfer his vote to the SDLP in East Belfast. This will not do much good, because the SDLP candidate in East Belfast is going to have been eliminated long before the Ulster Unionist votes are transferred. So it was a somewhat hollow promise in terms of the direct impact. At the same time, I think it may well have an indirect effect of the SDLP perhaps being a bit more inclined to make last-minute transfers to the Ulster Unionists, which may just make the difference in a few marginal cases. Internal solidarity, Unionists transferring to Unionists, Sinn Féin transferring to the SDLP and vice versa, that has always been a feature of Northern Ireland elections. But in fact, cross-community voting and transfers, it's relatively uncommon, but it's not at all new. In the Westminster elections, the SDLP has always benefited from borrowed unionist votes, as it's sometimes called, from habitual unionist voters in South Down and here who are voting SDLP to keep Sinn Féin out. Habitual nationalist voters recently have been returning the favour, an extraordinary turnaround in historical circumstances. It's pretty clear to me that Ian Paisley Jr. in North Antrim is getting a fair amount of Catholic support for people who do not want to see Jim Allister elected as their MP. In last year, transfers on the last count from the Ulster Unionists played a crucial role in two very interesting outcomes. One of them was in Fermanagh and South Tyrone, where the SDLP were struggling to retain the seat that they never should have lost in 2011. And on the very last count, they got 990 transfers from the Ulster Unionists and won the seat by 570 votes. Likewise, more the other way around, the last count in East Antrim was very tight between UKIP and Sinn Féin. UKIP were behind Sinn Féin by a significant but not insuperable distance. The Ulster Unionist candidate was eliminated, and looking at it, it seemed to me possible that if the Ulster Unionists faithfully transferred to UKIP, UKIP should have overtaken Sinn Féin. This, of course, was in the midst of the Brexit campaign, in which, as you will recall, the Ulster Unionists and UKIP took somewhat different perspectives. And in fact, UKIP ended up getting barely a third of the votes that they would have needed from the Ulster Unionists. And the last seat in East Antrim went again to Sinn Féin. On my way out of the TV studios in 2016 at the end of the election broadcast, I bumped into a leading member of the Ulster Unionists who had not heard this news and thought that UKIP had won the seat in East Antrim. And his delight when I told him that Sinn Féin had won instead was something that I never expected to see from an Ulster Unionist leadership figure. And the Alliance Party and other central parties, of course, always win some of their seats with transfers from both Unionists and Nationalists, and increasingly from smaller centre parties. There's some very interesting edge cases coming up, and these are the constituencies that I will be watching most closely for indications about these issues of communal solidarity and how cross-community transfers could affect the outcome. So these are the four, in my view, to watch. And I don't have a prediction, except that I think it's going to be very tight in all four cases. The first one, classically, the columns are going to be the quotas, in other words, percentage multiplied by six, that each was won by each bloc in 2016 last year. The first one, not surprisingly, it scores in all of these, is Fermanagh and South Tyrone, where Unionists scored just under Nationalists in 2016. But, you know, Unionists have tended to have better internal solidarity of transfers. But at the same time, will that be enough? And who knows what the overall effect of the fact that the leading Unionist candidate there is actually Ardeen Foster? Could that have an impact on the outcome? Defending candidates, it's two DUP, one Ulster Unionist, one SDLP, two Sinn Féin. All of those seats are very tight. I could see any one of them dropping. I could even see a situation where you actually get three Sinn Féin and two Unionists, which two I'm not sure. It's a particularly interesting one to call, and it may not be very clear until the last count. From the other perspective, East Londonderry, strongly Unionist seat, strong Nationalist minority. Nationalists marginally closer to two seats than the Unionists are to four. There are only five seats to give out. Three will be Unionist, one will be Nationalist. What is the last one? Current holders, this has been a constituency with a history of defections. One of the current MLAs is the heir of David McLarty, who was deselected by the Ulster Unionists and ran as an independent. The sitting SDLP MLA was also deselected and is standing as an independent against the official party candidate. It could all be quite a horrendous mess. So again, any outcome is possible here, including Sinn Féin gaining a seat and the Unionists losing one overall. From the other direction, South Down, where it's the Unionists who are a bit under two quotas and the Nationalists a bit under four. But I've put an asterisk beside the Unionist vote share there because I've included the votes for John McAllister, who'd been elected previously as an Ulster Unionist, then was briefly the deputy leader of MI21, for those who remember that far back, that brief window of time, and then stood and lost very badly as an independent in South Down last year. I had not realised until someone pointed out to me that none of John McAllister's first preference votes in that election transferred to other Unionist candidates. I say none, I mean less than 10%. So it could be that I shouldn't really be counting him in with the Unionist votes. In that case, it is the Nationalists who are closer to four seats than the Unionists are to two. Again, one to watch. Then from a totally different perspective, South Belfast, of course, where Unionists are just over two quotas, Nationalists are just over two quotas. Unionists defending two seats, Nationalists defending two seats, Alliance and Greens have one each. Wouldn't be at all surprised here to see the DUP having the only Unionist seat in the constituency, even if the Unionist vote share holds up. First of all, it's very fragmented. And secondly, this of all seats is one where people will take the Nesbitt advice and will be quite likely to vote Ulster Unionist first and SDLP second. I say quite likely. I mean, you know, 15-20% of Ulster Unionist voters might do that, which would be enough to knock out the second Unionist seat if the Ulster Unionists do badly, which, who knows, they may not, although I think that's not the way to bet. So that's my forecast for tomorrow and Friday. These are the seats to watch. I'm not going to predict the outcome other than to say that it's going to be close. I thought I should finish by looking into the far future. What happens when the day comes that a referendum is called on the border? We've seen already that voting behaviour at referendums is very different from voting behaviour at elections. So there's a real, I think we cannot take election results as a very clear guide to how people would vote in a referendum on whether or not to have a United Ireland. There is opinion poll evidence. My colleagues here at ARC, running the Northern Ireland Life and Times survey, have asked the question consistently since 1998 of what people see as the long-term future for Northern Ireland. In 1998, the questions changed slightly. In 1998, it was, should Northern Ireland remain part of the UK? 57% in favour. In 2014, that had risen to 66%, almost 10%, though it's split into 50% wanting devolution and 16% who would actually quite like to see direct rule brought back. Should Northern Ireland reunify with the rest of Ireland? 1998, 22%, 2014, 17%. I think that's within the margin of error of no change, actually, given the sensitivity of the question and given the known methodological difficulties in opinion polling. So that's around 20% of the population, which frankly is going to be around half the self-described Catholic share of the population, but not all. Should Northern Ireland be an independent state? This has fallen from not very much to even less in the years since the Good Friday Agreement. And finally, other don't know, probably lying, but that's what you do when you're faced with an opinion poll option. Again, constant around 12-16%. Wishful thinkers for any of these options may say, actually, the don't knows are really on our side. To which I will say, well, you don't actually know that. That's why they're called don't knows. There's been some scepticism about the Life and Times surveys precisely because their findings do not map very closely onto the election results. I think it's consistent with past history. I'm going to go way, way back to the 1968 survey of attitudes done by Richard Rose, who I'm glad to say is still very much alive and kicking. I met him in Brussels last year, retired professor at the University of Strathclyde. I'm sorry for the small font, but he asked two questions in 1968 before the Troubles had started. Attitudes to the border, what would you like to see happening? Abolish and unite Ireland was one of the options given. Also, abolish the border, alternative vague. The two abolish options got around half of Catholic support and around a quarter of Protestant support. But he also asked the question, on balance, there's been a lot of controversy about the constitutional position of Northern Ireland. That's a wonderfully 60s way of putting it, isn't it? Early 60s rather than late 60s. On balance, do you approve or disapprove of it? And again, division among Catholic respondents, more or less evenly split between they approve of the current situation, they disapprove of the current situation, and they don't know, or rather didn't want to tell the American guy with a clipboard, which is perfectly understandable. I see this as being within a spit of the more recent results found by Life and Times survey. It seems to me that basically 30 years of violence actually didn't change people's minds very much at all on the constitutional issue. However, I think something has happened that is going to change people's minds on the constitutional issue. And I referred to that earlier, and it is the Brexit referendum. And I've had my well-publicised differences with Bill Whyte and Lucid Talk in the past, but I think this is one of his findings that's very much worth paying attention to. And again, I'm sorry for the small font for those of you at the back. Lucid Talk, which is a local polling firm, put the question, a four-option question, to the public in general in January. And that was, please, you know, rank the following options in your order of preference from the most desired to the least desired. And this is the most desired options. Most popular, but only with 30%. Most popular option, Northern Ireland remains part of the UK and the UK remains part of the EU. Well, at least half of that is not going to happen now. Second option, 25%, Northern Ireland remains part of the UK and the UK leaves the EU, 25%. Next option with 24%, if the UK leaves the EU, so it's put conditionally, Northern Ireland should leave the UK and join the Irish Republic as one country, as a member of the European Union, 24% support. And that's not just the kind of wild-eyed optimists on the fringe, because the wild-eyed optimists have the fourth option, which is Northern Ireland should leave the UK and join the Irish Republic as one country, regardless of whether Ireland is a member of the European Union or not. and that got 20%. So the two united options there, which granted one of them is a bit conditional, although it's conditional on something we're pretty sure is going to happen, are now scoring a massive 44%. 44% not of Catholics, but of all respondents. And it's clear that Brexit has had a massive impact on the way that people here are thinking about their lives and their future. I can tell you it's having a massive impact in Brussels as well, but I think the impact is going to be much more directly felt here. It struck me a few weeks before the referendum, I had the pleasure of a chat over a great number of drinks with the First Minister of Gibraltar, who of course is even more existentially affected by the results than here is. And he was very clear to me that in Gibraltar it is a no-brainer. They wanted to stay in the EU, and they voted by 96% to stay in the EU, and they're looking for those 4% to try and find out who they are. Here, of course, we also have got a direct experience of a border, and if you think back to the slide I had with the results per constituency, all of the border constituencies voted to stay in the EU, voted to remain. Possibly for other reasons as well, but that to me was quite striking. We're in disruptive times in Europe. We've got elections coming up at the end of the month, sort of middle of the month in the Netherlands. We've got the French election coming up where there's been all kinds of extraordinary stuff happening. And we have French residents in the room who can maybe say a bit more. And we've got the German election coming up at the end of the year. Plus we've already had the extraordinary and bizarre and huge result in the United States, which is going to take us all some time to absorb. But it's clear that Brexit is having an immediate effect on Northern Ireland, on patterns of thought and behaviour that 30 years of violence had failed to shift. So welcome to the future, and thank you.